Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Good afternoon.
On behalf of our president, Ezekiel Robertson, and the ladies of Del Flamingo Mega Chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, I extend to you a very, very warm and pleasant greeting, and thank you for joining us this evening for this very, 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 very important occasion.
And on behalf of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, the Alpha Chapter, we also would like to greet you for this wonderful event.
The theme for this afternoon is Launching New Dimensions Through Science, Technology, Engineering, and Mathematics. And that will probably give you a clue about why we have our speaker here today. The program will proceed as printed with one exception. Instead of music by Ms. Morgan Monk, we're going to have Evan Butner. And we will only come back to the podium as necessary. The program is going to proceed as printed.
So up next, we have Introduction of Dais by Ms. Terry Jackson, Greetings by Ms. Tamika Robertson and Ms. Tredesia Sykes, and Invocation by Ms. Patricia Berry and Ms. Dwamisha McCon.
Founders Day Dais. Pat Barry, Jackie McCray, Aaliyah Glover, Carolyn Blakely, Damika Robertson, Tredesia Sykes, Regine Montague, Ava Jackson, and I am Terry Jackson.
Good afternoon. It is a great honor to welcome each of you to our 109th Founders Day program. I am Damika Robertson, president of the Delta Omega Omega chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, and I bring you warm greetings on behalf of the members of Delta Omega Omega. We are so proud that you took time out of your schedules to join us in welcoming such a dynamic figure by the name of Regine Montague. And we trust that your time will be enriched with new insights and knowledge. Today's program affords us the ability to focus on matters that are essential to our continued success and service to our community through science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. As we continue our powerful commitment to launching new dimensions of service, we trust that you will find the program to be useful and informative. Again, we welcome you and are so glad that you are here to learn, share, and celebrate the wonderful achievements and continued efforts of our magnificent organization, Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated. Thank you.
To our distinguished guest, Ms. Regine Montague, ladies, gentlemen, and to all who serve Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, good afternoon. My name is Tredesia Sykes, president of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, Alpha Rho Chapter. I am a senior here at the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, majoring in biology. We would like to welcome you all here today for our 109th Founders Day celebration, Launching New Dimensions Through Science, Technology, Engineering, and Mathematics. It is encouraging indeed to come together to support and honor women in the STEM field. We feel that this Founders Day celebration will serve as a platform for the extensive exchange of ideas among all participants, which will promote further relationships and actions leading to a better outcome towards the support for STEM in the state of Arkansas. Once again, on behalf of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, Alpha Rho Chapter, we would like to thank each of you for attending today, and we welcome you.
Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Oh, what memories we have being in Cowell Hall. Some of us back to the 50s, the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. Please bow with me as we pray. Gracious, loving, and almighty God, we are assembled in your presence and are very aware of your power and sovereignty.
And because of that, we humbly submit ourselves to you. We thank you for the founders of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority and the work the sorority has done for 109 years. We ask your blessings on our lives and request your approval upon the things we do that are designed to serve others and to improve our own lives. Help us to be reminded that you have allowed us these precious days to use our many gifts and talents while working in harmony and encouraging one another to do well. Dear God, continue to bless us and keep us in your will as we walk closer to you every day. We acknowledge your Holy Spirit as our guide and pledge that all we do, in word or deed, we do it all until Jesus Christ, your Son, as you have commanded us to do in your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say, amen.
Amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. Could you all bow your heads and close your eyes? Lord Heavenly Father, we're coming to you today to thank you for allowing us all to meet in this place. We want to thank you for our safe travels and our praying for a safe departure. Father, please allow this celebration to be filled with happiness and joy and allow us to learn from our precious speaker. Father, we want to thank you again for everything you have done. God willing, going into this new week, Father, I ask that you would please just cover us with the blood of Jesus and protect us from all things that aren't your way. We ask that you bless us with the fruit of the Spirit as we embark upon another journey. Thanks again for being a gracious and merciful Father you are. In your Son, Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good afternoon. Sisters of Alpha Rho Chapter and Delta Omega Omega Chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, and all of our Greek and other friends who have come to join us today, I have been asked by Chancellor Alexander to extend my welcome on this occasion and to share the bond that exists between the university and all of its Divine Nine organizations. Delta Omega Omega and Alpha Rho share a rich history with the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, as does all of the other Greek letter organizations on campus. But since this is the founding of Alpha Kappa Alpha, I'm going to talk about the relationship between the university and Alpha Kappa Alpha. Okay, Alpha Rho and Delta Omega Omega share a rich history. UAPB, AM, and N played a major role in the organization of both of these chapters. For those who are charter members of Delta Omega Omega, nine were either faculty members or their spouses were faculty members. But the organization required 10 members to charter a chapter. So, we were very fortunate that in the fall of 1948, a soror, Irma Glasgow Davis, transferred from Tennessee State to AM&N and gave Pine Bluff a 10th Alpha Kappa Alpha woman, and we were able to establish a chapter. Of course, Alpha Rho could not exist without UAPB, and UAPB would be much less strong without Alpha Rho and the other members of the Divine Nine. So, UAPB doesn't need to welcome you to campus today because our founding is affiliated with the campus. UAPB stands here today ready to celebrate all that is Alpha Kappa Alpha in both chapters, and what those chapters have contributed to the growth and vitality of the university, and to celebrate the nurture and guidance that the university gives to all of its organizations, and particularly all of its Greek letter organizations. So in the absence of Chancellor Alexander, I'm delighted to greet my beautiful sorors and all others who have come to celebrate with us.
I want to extend congratulations to both chapters for your presence at UAPB and the work we do in the Pine Bluff community. Finally, on behalf of Chancellor Alexander, I extend three accolades to Alpha Kappa Alpha women assembled today. The first is to the members of both chapters who are today celebrating the 116th anniversary of the founding of our sisterhood. The second is to the chartering of Delta Omega Omega chapter over 69 years ago. And the third is for the 66th birthday of Alpha Rho chapter. AMNN UAPB is grateful for the bond that it has made with Alpha Kappa Alpha and the other two organizations on campus. We share a strong bond of respect, mutual support, and love. It's a great partnership, and the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff is better because Alpha Kappa Alpha and the other Greek organizations are a vital part of the university's heart and soul. Welcome.
We are approaching the podium once again. We are scheduled to read, although the program says a proclamation just from the mayor's office, we actually have two proclamations. So I'll share one from the mayor's office, and Aaliyah will do the one from the Senate. Office of the Mayor, City of Pine Bluff Proclamation. Whereas Raye Jean Jordan, RPE, is a retired internationally registered professional engineer who was raised in Pine Bluff and is recognized as Arkansas's own hidden figure. And whereas Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated Delta Omega Omega and Alpha Rho chapters will be celebrating their Founders Day on February 12, 2017, the chapters will be honoring Mrs. Montague for her contributions to our community, our state, and our nation. She served in the United States Navy for 33.5 years. She is credited with the rough draft of the first U.S. naval ship design using a computer, FFG7 class, which revolutionized naval ship design and was awarded the United States Navy's Meritorious Civilian Services Award in 1972. The same year, she was nominated by the Secretary of the Navy for the Federal Woman of the Year Award. Montague was a regular presenter to the U.S. Department of Defense's Joint Chiefs of Staff on computer-related aspects of naval ship design and construction. She also served as the Secretary of the Board of Directors for the Numerical Control Society, and she was the first female to serve on this board. In 2006, after 50 years spent in the metropolitan Washington, D.C. area, she returned to Arkansas, and in 2013, she was inducted into the Arkansas Black Hall of Fame. Now, therefore, I, Shirley Washington, Mayor of the City of Pine Bluff, Arkansas, do hereby proclaim February 12, 2017, as Raye Jean Montague Day.
Senate citation, whereas Ms. Raye Jean Montague, a Little Rock native, a retired professional engineer, and a fifth-year member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated Beta Pi Omega chapter, will be the guest speaker at the 109th Founders Day celebration of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated Delta Omega Omega and Alpha Rho chapters, to be held on the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff campus on February 12, 2017. And whereas the members of the Arkansas Senate wish to join Senator Stephanie Flowers in expressing appreciation to Ms. Raye Jean Montague for her long and exemplary service to her country and in congratulating her on her well-deserved honors for accomplishments as a professional female engineer. Now, therefore, pursuant to the motion of Senator Stephanie Flowers, the Arkansas Senate directs that this citation be presented on the 12th day of February 2017, signed by President Pro Tem Jonathan Dismay and Senator Stephanie Flowers. I also want to recognize Ms. Stephanie Flowers. Thank you.
Senator Baby and Fly, but. Senator Vivian Flowers, representative, can you please come up? Sorry.
As she approaches the stage, we will be entertained following that by music from the Pinecliff High School History Club Chorale, and followed by brief history of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority by Betty Wright.
Believe it or not, that happens a lot, so. It is my honor and pleasure to be here to present this citation. I'll just go ahead and read it, but before I do, I just want to say that the contributions of Mrs. Montague are so incredible, and I couldn't stand here and just read this to share what she has meant to this country, and to Arkansas, to Pine Bluff, and to Little Rock. And just probably about 3 weeks ago, I had an opportunity to participate in the Women's March in Arkansas, and I based my remarks on the hidden figures of Katherine Johnson, Dorothy Vaughan, and Mary Jackson. And so I just wanted to say that the power of women in this room and in this state and this country are so important to the examples that we set. And so without those hidden figures, there is no Mrs. Montague. There is no Aaliyah. And so I just want to make that point, and I'll just stop there. Mrs. Raye Montague, RPE, for those of you who don't know, that's a registered professional engineer. Whereas Mrs. Raye Montague, RPE, who is an internationally registered professional engineer, began her career in 1956 and retired in 1990 after more than a 33-year career in Washington, D.C. with the United States Navy. And whereas Mrs. Montague, who is known as Arkansas's own hidden figure, is an outstanding individual and is to be commended for her significant contributions to the U.S. Navy, where she is credited with creating the rough draft of the first U.S. naval ship designed using computer FFG7 class 1971, which revolutionized naval ship design to become the program manager of ships, was awarded the U.S. Navy's Meritorious Civilian Service Award in 1972. In 2013, was inducted into the Arkansas Black Hall of Fame and received a host of other honors from the military throughout her career. And whereas Mrs. Montague, who was born in Little Rock, Arkansas, and raised in Pine Bluff, Arkansas, as a child, dreamed of becoming an engineer. However, she was not allowed to attend the University of Arkansas at Fayetteville because of her race and gender. Attended AM&N College and graduated in 1956 with a business degree, and was later encouraged by her mother and former Merrill High School teacher to pursue her dreams and eventually become an engineer, designing ships for the United States Navy. And whereas Mrs. Montague is now a 50-year golden member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, Beta Pi Omega chapter in Little Rock, Arkansas, and whereas the House of Representatives of the 91st General Assembly of the State of Arkansas takes great pride in recognizing Mrs. Raye Montague, RPE, for her outstanding accomplishments and wishes her well. Now, therefore, pursuant to the motion of Representatives Vivian Flowers and Ken Ferguson, the Arkansas House of Representatives directs that this citation be presented on this 8th day of February, 2017.
My name is Michael Richards, the director of the Pinecliff High School History Club Chorale, and we will be singing Kirk Franklin's "The Storm Is Over Now." At the moment, we have no musicians, so we will be singing a cappella, and we will do our best. Oh, there's the musician.
Thank you. Now. of applause. And as Dr. Wright is coming to the stage, we will also have introduction and bio by Ms. Ava Jackson, followed by music by Mr. Edward Buckner.
I know that we promised that we were not coming back up here for a few minutes, but we cannot afford to just not take every advantage that we have to congratulate young people. And I also want to say that one of the young ladies goes to my church. Good afternoon, students and other esteemed sororities and fraternities in Greekdom, friends, and sorors. Alpha Kappa Alpha is the first Greek letter sorority established and incorporated by African American college women. The sorority was founded on January 15, 1908 at Howard University in Washington, D.C. 109 years ago by a group of nine students led by Ethel Hedgman Lyle. Forming a sorority broke barriers for African American women in areas where little power or authority existed due to a lack of opportunities for minorities and women in the early 20th century. Alpha Kappa Alpha was incorporated on January 29, 1913. Today, Alpha Kappa Alpha consists of college-educated women of African, Caucasian, Asian, and Hispanic descent. The sorority serves through a membership of more than 290 women in over 1,005 chapters in the United States and other countries. Since being founded over a century ago, Alpha Kappa Alpha has helped to improve social and economic conditions through community service programs. Members have improved education through independent initiatives, contributed to community building by creating programs and associations such as the Mississippi Health Clinic, and influenced federal legislation by congressional lobbying through the National Nonpartisan Lobby on Civil and Democratic Rights. The sorority works with communities through service initiatives and progressive programs relating to education, family, health, and business. Alpha Kappa Alpha is part of the National Panhellenic Council. The current international president is Dorothy Buchanan Wilson, and the sorority's document and pictorial archives are located at Moreland Spingarn Research Center in Washington, D.C., on the Howard University's campus. In the Pine Bluff community, Delta Omega Omega chapter was chartered in 1948 and Alpha Rho chapter at the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff was chartered in 1951. Both chapters worked diligently to promote service to all mankind through the Jefferson County community and the state of Arkansas. Thank you.
Since protocol has already been established, I'll get right to the point. To the bacilli of Delta Omega Omega and Alpha Rho chapters, all other sorors, ladies and gentlemen, it is a pleasure for me to stand before you and introduce to some and present to others my classmate and sorority sister, Mrs. Raye Jean Jordan Montague. Ray and I met as freshmen at A&M College, now UAPB, back in the 50s, and became good friends. She was a gifted student and majored in business. She wanted to become an engineer, but the only Arkansas college that offered engineering was the University of Arkansas at Fayetteville. And this university did not accept minorities at that time. That, however, did not deter her from her goal. After graduation, she started her career with the Navy as a digital computer system operator. She later advanced to the position of computer system analyst at the Naval Ship Engineering Center. She served as the program director for the Naval Sea Systems Command, Integrated Design, Manufacturing, and Maintenance Program, as well as the division head for the computer-aided design and computer-aided manufacturing program called CAD/CAM. Her career spanned the development of computer technologies from UNIVAC 1, which was the world's first commercially available computer, down to modern computers. She successfully revised the first automated system for selecting and printing specifications. The rough draft of a ship design normally required 2 years, but she produced the first rough draft of the naval frigate ship in 18 hours and 26 minutes. This was the first ship designed by computer. The last project she was affiliated with was the Seawolf class, which was a nuclear submarine. She was the first female program manager of ships in the Navy. As a program manager, she was responsible for 5 field activities, comprising a staff of 250 people, and she was in charge of purchasing equipment for 1,111 people. She worked on the USS Dwight D. Eisenhower, which was CVN 69, and the Navy's first landing craft helicopter assault ship. She was a regular presenter to the United States Defense Department's Joint Chiefs of Staff on computer-related aspects of the naval ship design and construction. She was the first female to serve as the secretary of the board of directors for the Numerical Control Society. Among the many awards and recognitions Ray received are as follows: the United States Navy's Meritorious Civilian Service Award in 1972, which is the Navy's third highest honor. Federal Woman of the Year Award, nominated by the Secretary of the Navy. The Society of Manufacturing Engineers Achievement Award in 1978. The National Computer Graphics Association Award for the Advancement of Computer Graphics in 1988. And she was inducted into the 2013 Black Hall of Fame. She has also received many other honors for military branches, industry, and academia. One of her most cherished memories is when the United States flag, which flew the nation's capital in Washington, D.C., in her honor, was presented to her when she retired. Katherine Johnson, the sole surviving African-American actress from the movie Hidden Figures, and Ray were honored at Hampton University 7 years ago. They were given plaques stating they should have been nominated for a Nobel Prize for their service. Raye retired in 1990. In 2006, after 50 years spent in the Washington, D.C. area, she returned to Arkansas, residing in Little Rock. She remains active in LifeQuest, the Lynx, Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, the American Contract Bridge League, the American Association of University Women, Christ the King Catholic Church, and mentoring prisoners to return to society. Some of us may remember some of her fine bluff of ancestry. Those of you in my league may remember Dr. William E. O'Brien. He was an enthusiastic alumnus of Branch Normal College, which was one of the older names for this institution. He was a very good friend of Prexy Davis Sr., Dr. Lawrence A. Davis Sr., we call him Prexy. And he and Dr. O'Brien were very good friends, and he was at many of the assemblies. Well, now Raye has a connection to Dr. O'Brien. That's her grand uncle. He was a pharmacist here and a strong supporter of this university. Now, Raye will be on Good Morning America on the 20th of this month. So if you all tune in to GMA. On February 20th, and see her there. Now, let us stand and give this hidden figure a standing ovation and welcome. Thank you, Mrs. Jackson, but we have a community report. We would not be coming to the Evan Buckner, he's on his way up.
This is a piece by Duke Ellington entitled In a Sentimental Mood.
Two chapters, and to all you lovely people, thank you. for coming out to hear me today. It's wonderful to be home. And even though I was born in Little Rock and spent my early years there, I came to Pine Bluff and I graduated from Merrill High School. And it's important for you to know how I decided to become an engineer, because back in those days, you didn't hear about such things. During World War II, I was 7 years old, and the United States captured a German mini submarine off of the coast of the Carolinas. And they brought it on tour, and the tour stopped in Little Rock. And my grandfather took me down to see the sub. Why, I don't know. But they let me go up the little ladder and down the hatch. And I saw all the periscope, the dials, and the mechanism, and I was fascinated. And I said to the guy who was giving the spiel, what do you have to know to do this type of thing? He said, oh, you'd have to be an engineer, but you don't ever have to worry about that. And I said, you said I'd have to be an engineer? And he said, yes, but like I said, you don't ever have to worry about that. Well, I didn't know I'd been insulted. Well, I didn't know what an engineer was required to become an engineer, so I asked my mother to take me to find out. And of course, she took me in with all the math and science. My mother was also a very strong woman, and she taught me as a very little girl, Raye, you'll have three strikes against you. You're female, and you're black. Well, at that time, the terminology was Negro. And you'll have a Southern segregated school education. But you can do or be anything you want to be, provided that you're educated. You must be educated. That was drilled in me. She said, you are going to college. It's a matter of what you're going to major in. So I never thought that I wasn't going to college. And of course, with Dr. O'Brien, who was my grand uncle, whom the bell tower is dedicated to out there. Most people don't realize that he's my grandmother's brother. Okay. Dr. O'Brien always talked to me about, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I say, an engineer. Well, my classmates at Merrill thought that I wanted to drive a train, because that's what they knew an engineer did. Mrs. Irma Holliday heard them teasing me one day, and she said, Raye, don't get upset about them teasing you. Aim for the stars. At the very worst, you'll land on the moon. Well, I took that seriously. And of course, when I graduated high school in 1952, as Ava said to you, the University of Arkansas at Fayetteville did not accept minorities. There was no other school in the state to give me an engineering degree. So I came here and I got a Bachelor of Science in Business, but again, taking all the math and science. And one of the reasons that people ask me why I can speak so freely and so comfortably, I was a debater in high school and in college. Tippy Jones, you remember him? Any of you? Okay, well, and we traveled, and we debated, and we spoke, okay, in front of a big audience. And so that came into play for me in my work, because other people were timid. And you know, my thing is, I can be anything I want to be. So one of the things that the Navy found when they were the first ones to call me in for an interview when I went to Washington, and they said, oh, you've got a degree of a Bachelor of Science. You're on the leading edge of technology. I didn't know that. And they said, you'll know all about our computer. I'd never seen a computer. And Arkansas didn't have a computer back in those days. But of course, I've been well taught, Daryl and Pine and Aven Ed to say, of course I do. So they sent me to work with guys who had graduated from Yale and Harvard with degrees in engineering, and people who had worked on the Manhattan Project developing the atom bomb. And what they didn't know was that I had a photographic memory. I could listen, be called to conversations and listen to a third, and I learned, okay? So, a couple of weeks after I was there, young people who could operate the computer, or touch the computer, were engineers. They were all white guys, all right. So my job was to go out and compare metallic tapes in the morning to see what errors printed. And the cockpit, well, the console of a UAPB looked like the cockpit of an aircraft, okay? All the dials and switches. So I said to this guy, after 2 weeks, his name was John McKendra, I'll never forget it. I said, John, teach me to operate the computer. He said, no, I teach you to operate the computer, you'd have my job. Well, you can't think that I'm going to stand here and watch you do something for 2 weeks and not figure out what you're doing. I didn't tell him that. But 2 weeks later, all the engineers called in sick. And I went over and mounted my little tapes. I was the first person on in the morning. And no one showed up to operate the computer for me. And I slowly but surely went over and started to flip switches and do type-ins, and the tapes took off. Well, I have great peripheral vision too, thank you. And I could see my coworkers peeping around the corner. And you see, back in those days, they resented me because I was from Arkansas. And they didn't think we wore shoes down here. So, in a few minutes, here comes my boss. And he stood, and I never stopped working, and I could see him with my peripheral vision. And he stood there and he watched me, and then he spoke to me softly like he would to a child. And he said, Raye, I didn't know you knew how to operate the computer. And I said, I don't. He said, well, what are you doing? I said, well, I know how to do enough to get my job done. He said, fine, you know more than any of the rest of us here. So from now on, this is your job. So I did take that cast job. Well, the next day, the guys had to come in and teach me. They were told they had to teach me the fine things, because I was operating that computer. Now, all of you are familiar with the decimal system, but you operated the UAPB computer in excess 3 binary. So you knew I wasn't taught that here. Well, then my job was to teach the other civilians how to operate the computer. And it didn't take me long to realize that the guys I was teaching were starting to make more money than I was making. Hey, that didn't work. Remember, I've been told I could do anything. So I went to my manager and I said, I taught them why they're making more money than me. He said, oh, they can work at night. And you don't have a car, you can't come in at night. I said, so if I had a car and could come in at night, I could make the same money as they did. He said, yeah, he thought that was the end of it. Next day, I went out and I bought to a used car lot. And I bought a 1949 Pontiac for $375. And I had the salesman to drive it to my home. And I volunteered to work midnight shift for a month. And I'd leave home at 10 o'clock at night, and I'd go no mile an hour across D.C. driving to get to work. And I get there, and I go, phew. And I'd work all night. And when the day shift would come in, they thought I was being so nice because I'd help them to mount their tapes and laugh and talk with them until about 9:30. And what they didn't realize, I was letting traffic ease up so I could go no mile an hour. So, coincidentally, One of my aunts died the same day that they had Black Friday at Central High. So my mother called me and asked me if I could come home. And I said, yes. Well, we didn't have a car when I was growing up. But in that time, short time that I was gone, my mother had been able to get a car. So one of her friends worked at the courthouse. And he saw me driving my mother's car. And he said, Raye, I saw you driving your mother's car. Do you have a license? I said, no. He said, do you want one? I said, yes. And about 2 hours later, he came and just tossed my license over to me. So I go back to D.C., and I go to Department of Vehicle Registration, and they honored my Arkansas permit. And so therefore, I had a D.C. permit. Thank you. And I go back to work. Naturally, I'm proud of my permit, and I'm showing them all around. And everybody's laughing. And the manager came out and he said, what's so funny? I said, I'm showing them my driver's permit. He said, obviously you had one all the time. I said, no, I didn't. He said, you've been driving in here on this military base and you didn't have a driver's permit? I said, yes. He said, well, you did have a learner's permit, didn't you? I said, no. Well, why didn't you? I said, because I didn't know how to drive. He said, well, who taught you how to drive? I said, I taught myself coming in here at midnight. Needless to say, I got equal pay. Time went by, and I hope I'm not taking too long. Okay, all right. But time went by, and we received the first transistorized computer, and it was called the Lark. And we had a little guy who was running, was supposed to be running the show, and he didn't know how to debug programs. I had sent myself to computer programming school at night, my own expense, and people would come to me to debug their programs and tell them what was wrong with the system. So this guy felt like, hey, I can't compete with her. So he resigned. And the manager came up and he said, well, Raye, if you'll do this for 6 months and work three shift operation, you'll be promoted to the supervisor. I said, okay. So I'm running this thing and I'm teaching everybody and debugging all the programs. And when 6 months was up, I said, okay, Jack, what about my promotion? He said, oh, there's a freeze on. Well, that's what they always tell you when they don't want to promote you. And I said, how's there a freeze on when I see everybody else around here being promoted? You mean there's a freeze just on me? He said, well, Raye, I'll be honest with you. You have the right name, but you're the wrong sex. I can't stand women in supervisory positions. I wish the guys worked as hard as you did. And I hope you won't leave us, because we really need you. I said, well, you can bet your bippy I'm not staying here. Well, I went out in the computer room and I started filling out applications, writing letters, and people heard. And Betty Holbert, who was the one who helped to work on the atom bomb, came down. She was very wealthy, but she was doing what she wanted to do. But she came down, she said, Raye, is it true what he said to you? And I said, yes. She said, I didn't know that you had been going through this all your career. And I said, yes, I've had to fight every step of the way and create every job I've had. She said, would you consider coming to work with me? And she was developing all the operating systems for computers. And I said, yes, I will. Well, ironically enough, personnel decided I had to take the Federal Service Entrance Exam after all these years. So I went down, I took it, and I passed it. And then their attitude was, score isn't high enough. So I took it the second time, passed it. All you had to do was make 70. I made 90-something every time. So Betty Holbert said, Raye, next time you take it, bring your score to me. Don't go to personnel. So I did. And she went with me to personnel and she said, okay, she passed you three times. What are you going to say now? They said, well, we've never had a non-engineer or non-mathematician working as a systems analyst and doing the whole systems programming. And we don't want to establish a precedence now. So Betty Holbrook said, pull my personnel jacket. And they did. And Betty Holbrook had a degree in journalism. Okay? Needless to say, I was moved into Betty Holbrook's group. But she said, I can't stand to work in a place that treat people like this. So she gave me a copy of the promotion that she was going to put in for me. She said, in case they decide to lose it and get dispersed now, here's your copy. And she decided and went to head up the same thing at Bureau of Standards. Well, needless to say, they did lose my promotion. And I said, here's my copy. And from there, things were different to a point. But I still ran into a lot of problems. The guys still resented me. And I was at a meeting one day down at what they call Main Navy downtown. And one of the guys said, Ray, we'd like to have you come to work with us at Naval Ship Engineering Center. What would it take to get you? And I said, I don't know how many of you are familiar with GS ratings, but at the time I said, I want a GS 12 to come and a 13 in a year. He said, let me go back and talk to my boss. By the time I got back to my office, he called and said, you got it. Well, what they didn't realize, since I never used a title, that I was, and my name was Ray Montague, everybody assumed I was a white man. And because based on my reputation, and people just didn't bother to say that I was black and a female. So I go to work at this new organization, and 3 days later, the new manager comes in. He says, hi, I've come in to meet the new guy. And I said, hi, I'm Ray Montague. And you always extend that hand, okay? You make them shake hands with you. And if there's anybody standing around, it's embarrassing if you hold your hand out there long enough, if they don't shake hands with you and look them dead in the eye, don't ever look down, okay? And smile, okay? Well, he was racist. And he decided, how am I gonna get rid of this wrestling? So he gave me a 6-month deadline on a project that the Navy had been working on for 6 years and had spent at that time over $600,000. And I found out that the contractors working on it were in New York City. It was Rosenblatt and Sons, naval architecture firm. And everybody they had set up before to check out the system were at very high levels. When they'd gone up, they started at high levels. They didn't understand what was going on. And what did I do? I checked into a hotel in New York at Navy expense and went to work every day on Wall Street with Rosenblatt and Son. And I found they were much further along than anybody anticipated. And I figured out their system. And for those of you who are old enough to know, high-speed printers printed uppercase letters across the page. What the Navy wanted was upper and lowercase printouts, two-column prints like you have on a newspaper. Well, I'm trying to figure out how in the devil am I going to reprogram this thing? And this is where networking comes in. I was talking to one of the guys that I knew out at Boeing Aircraft, and he said, well, Ray, I understand that IBM has perfected something they call a TN chain that's upper and lower case. see if you can get the Navy to buy it for you. And I did, and the Navy bought it. Well, I'd come into work, couldn't get enough computer time during the day. Because I had to tear the system apart and reassemble it. So I'd work all day, then cut off the computer at 7 o'clock at night. I'd go home, and I'd come back at 7:30, fire up the system, tear it apart, and work until midnight. Didn't charge me an extra dime, go home. So after a week or so, the manager comes in. Ray, you can't work here alone at night. And I said, well, I need to meet my deadline. I need to be able to do the system, you know, tear the system apart. He said, well, you can't work alone. Well, I asked some of the coworkers. Remember, I'm new at this place. And they resented me because I had come in at a higher level than most black women. So they said, we can't work unless you pay us overtime. And I said, I can't pay you overtime, but if I make this thing fly, you can have all the overtime you want. Nobody would agree to work, so what did I do? My son was 3 years old, and I brought my son and my mother in. And I put my mother over in the corner and let her work crossword puzzles. And my son, I taught him to program computers in BASIC. A equals 1, B equals 2, C equals A plus B, print C. He's programming. And then I put him over in a corner on a key punch machine and let him punch up all the government's cards. Okay. And when he got sleepy, I put him on a desk and cover him with a blanket and I work until midnight and I go home. Well, after a couple of weeks, the manager comes to me, Ray, why are you bringing your mother and son in here? They don't work here. I said, well, you told me I couldn't come in and work alone. I'm not alone. He said, are you that determined to meet your deadline? I said, I didn't know I had a choice. Next day, I had a staff from 4 to 12. So then, and I'll get through this in a minute, but as I met the deadline, and I said to the manager, give me a true ship to design. He said, oh, nobody's going to give you a true ship. We just wanted to see if you could make this work, because we thought it was an impossible task. And I said, you mean I have work and I can't off, and you all want to go use this stuff? And he said, no, nobody's going to use it. Well, I'm ticked off, and I go back to my desk. And I don't want anybody to talk to me. Don't even come near me. 2 weeks later, I don't know how President Nixon found out about it, but he contacted the Navy and told them instead of the 2 years required to do the rough draft of a design of a ship, I'm giving you all 2 months to do it. And the admirals came to me and they said, young lady, we understand you've got a system to design ships. And I said, yes. They said, well, the president has given us 2 months rather than 2 years. We can give you a month. Can you do it? I brought that rascal in 18 hours and 26 minutes. So that, my career just took off, okay? Still had to struggle. Still had to fight, I fought until the day I retired. But the Department of Defense recognized what I had done. And as the Secretary of the Navy said that when he nominated me to be Federal Woman of the Year, that I had revolutionized the design process for all naval ships and submarines. And so can you imagine, the Department of Defense sets up a special crew called Manufacturing Technology Advisory Group, and we call it MTAG. But we're, and Bob's in DOD on the manufacturing technology that's being used. It's just unreal, you know. I said, little girl from Little Rock, advice in the Department of Defense on technology. Well, anyway, they sent me around the world, essentially, and I got an awful lot of visibility. I actually worked with the British and the Australians on their ships because the United States were the leaders at that time in design ships. So I worked with the Brits and Australians. And I can remember when I was in Toronto, Canada, and one of the guys came up to me and he said, after I spoke, and he said, "You know, you've got a pretty face. Why are you doing this?" I said, "Because I have a pretty face doesn't mean I don't have a brain." So, you know, but that was the way things went. And I got all sorts of awards and recognition, as Abel told you. One of the key ones that's always amusing to me is when I received the award in Anaheim, California, as the grandmother of computer graphics. And my escort was Roy Disney, Jr. Can you imagine? And then when I'd gone as far as I could as an engineer, and I believe not many stories, but when I'd gone as far as I could as an engineer, they advertised for program managerships, and I applied. And when I was selected, they found that I was the first female program managerships in the history of the Navy. And as Ava told you, I had 5 field activities. But what you, it was amusing, I had a field activity at Pearl Harbor, one at Puget Sound Naval Shipyard, Maryland Naval Shipyard, Norfolk Naval Shipyard, and Indian Head Proving Grounds. I had, and this is where AMN's degree in business comes into play. Engineers don't know how to do this, the regular engineers. But I had a line item in the federal budget. And I had to go and defend my budget, and then I would go over to the Pentagon and brief Vice Admiral Rich, who was the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, once a month. I'd drive my little car over to the Pentagon and go in and sit and have coffee with him and brief him. That was wonderful. I was responsible for the procurement of CAD-CAM equipment for 111,000 people. And that line item in the budget was significant. And, you know, and I always say, thanks to AMN in college. Okay, now, I'm finished. You all can ask any questions.
You are one fantastic lady. What I would like to know is, out of all of the trials and things you went through, do you have any regrets?
Not really. I ended up being a single mother. My husband and I separated when my son was just 9 weeks old. So I was mother and father to him. And at first I felt like I'd done him a disservice. But now I look at his accomplishments and I say, hey, I did a good job.
We have 2 young ladies who have a question for you as well.
Sure, ma'am.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Elise Darden, and I go to Palm Beach High School, and I am a member of the Ivy Center for Education. And my question is, do you think there would be a movie made about your life story? And if so, can I be in it?
It would be nice if they did make a movie, but the fact that they made the one concerning the women in NASA. I think they won't push another one. However, you heard them say that I belong to LifeQuest. That's my senior citizens group. And when I spoke there several years ago, someone there contacted Hallmark, and Hallmark said they needed a script. But so far, nobody's produced a script, so but I'd love to have you play the part.
Good afternoon. My name is Priscilla Foreman, and I'm also a member of the Iverson for Education, and I'm a student at the Whitehall High School. Ms. Ray, you had to go through a whole bunch of obstacles in your life, being African-American, being a woman. What kept you inspired through all those ordeals?
Remember, I was told that I could do anything provided I was educated.
Right.
And I believed that. I really believed that. There's so many hidden figures from Arkansas that just haven't been acknowledged. How many of you remember Samuel Coons? I know you do, Joseph. You will. Samuel Coons did the first kidney transplant. And all these other people have claimed credit for it, but Samuel Coons was a graduate of the AM&M. And you don't hear anything about his story. Okay, Henry Wilkins was your first Black legislator in the state of Arkansas. Henry passed on, and now we have Josetta. Josetta, it didn't say too much about her. Josetta and I went to high school together, and Henry Wilkins, Henry and I started school in fifth grade. He was a little ahead, I was in fifth grade. But until Josetta did this thing on breast cancer, they didn't want to publicize her. As such, there are a lot of hidden figures. I can just name a lot of people that I know who have gone on to do marvelous things.
Oh, hi. Hello, Ms. Montague. My name is Deborah Jackson. I'm a senior here at the college, here at this college. I major in biology. I'm actually in the ROTC department. I'll commission as an engineering officer. In May. As a Black woman and also being an officer in the military is already hard. Did you have any advice that you could probably give me that I could probably keep close to my heart so I can stay focused on what I need to do?
You can do anything you want to do. Okay. And don't feel threatened when people try to run circles around you or treat you in a negative manner. Hold it close to your heart. Never let them know that you've got, that they've upset you, okay? Never let them know that. But you'll get them later, okay? Because you'll run circles on them. That's the important thing. You've got to do your homework. I'm a night person. The guys that I worked with were day people. And they never realized that I didn't function that well early in the morning. But man, at night when they're full of beer and we're locked up someplace at 10, 11 o'clock and we're working on an Air Force project or something of that type, I say, hey guys, look at this page. They said, Ray, don't you ever run down. They never knew that I was dragging in the morning. Okay? That's your little secret. All right?
Right. I guess it's more of an adversarial question. When I listened to your story and how you kind of stood out, you know, and how do you give me advice?
Get it together. You don't ever let them see you cry. You say, yeah.
It's more
you might go to your car and cry like a baby. Clean yourself up.
I know,
and
my sister always tell me that. But these are tears of joy.
Yeah.
Because listening to your story and you had the obstacles.
Yes.
But when I listen to your story, and I look at myself, you stood there, and no matter what, you had the, in your head, because what I'm thinking is, you stood alone, but you still stood your ground. So I guess what my question would be, as an adversarial for me, that in my career, I had to stand alone because I believe in right. It's no shady gray areas with me. So would you give me advice on continue to stand alone, but I know I'm not standing alone because of the grace of God. Because I've always been the type that I stand for right, and I may ruffle some feathers, but still I stand alone. And I see that you've done that. So my question is, I guess it's not a, am I doing it right or am I doing it wrong? But is it right for me to keep it in my head that I have to stand for what I believe in?
Yes.
Because there's only one side that I'm listening to the word, and I tell them, I don't want you to agree with me, and I don't want you to agree with them. I want you to agree with right, because it's a passion of mine in criminology and criminal justice. So I guess the advice that I'm asking from you is, you know, what do you think when you stand alone? When you stood alone, but you made it.
I'm still alone, darling, in many cases. However, you'll find that the more prominent you are and the further up you go, the lonelier it gets. People don't realize that you don't have the people that you normally feel that you can confide in and trust. In many cases, are not your friends. They are what we call haters. Okay? Now, all of us have run into that in some days. And they will stab you in the back. They'll grin in your face. Or they'll say, hey, you're crazy to be doing this. But you know within yourself that you're right. And you stand your ground. You might have to step back. I have a PowerPoint presentation that I do. I go to schools, churches, anywhere anybody invites me, and I'm free, okay, if you ever need me. But my PowerPoint presentation is changing obstacles into challenging situations. And my obstacle is when they say you can't or you're wrong. You might have to step back, and it might take a longer time, but you change that to a challenging situation, and you can still advance and, in my case, excel. And you can do the same thing. But you've got to be strong about it and convinced. Okay?
Do we have any more questions? Good evening, Ms. Raye.
Hello,
my name is Michaela Howard. I'm a member of Delta Omega Omega Chapter here in Pine Bluff. First off, let me just say thank you. Your whole life is inspiring. My question is that, well, I work with children in the Boys and Girls Club. I serve as a unit director here in Pine Bluff. And I know around the age of, or the grades of fourth to fifth grade, girls start losing interest in math and science. Being that you had an entire career in this field, what advice would you give a fourth or fifth grade girl who's getting to the point where she's losing interest in math and science to go for it and basically become what you are?
You don't wait until they're fourth and fifth graders, okay? At three, the brain is like a sponge. You don't have boy toys and you don't have girl toys. You have toys, okay? And I was tearing trucks apart. Give them the trucks, give them the other stuff, but also provide the feminine stuff. But we all have the mind to do anything we want to do. And you have to stress to them that there's no such thing as women's work or men's work. So many people say, oh, I can't do that, that's for men. Bull, okay? you can do anything, and you start them at 3 doing mechanical stuff. Along with the others, you don't discourage the feminine stuff, but you keep pushing it in, and you keep giving them the math and the science early on. I sent my son to Montessori school the day he turned 3. I remember I told you I taught this Russell program 3. But at Montessori, he was taking French, biology, geometry, and mathematics at 3. And I convinced him that when you graduate and go to college, we're going to do this, that, and the other. And so when he graduated from this Montessori school, he was 6 years old. And when my friend saw him and said, "Well, David, how's it feel to graduate and go to first grade?" He said, "I'm going to first grade." My mama said, "When I graduated, I was going to college." So this is what you have to do, whether it's a girl or a boy. You brainwash them. And I use the term brainwashing, because that's what is required. They do what they hear and what they see. Okay?
Thank you so much. We're now down to presentation. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon. I'm Chandra Griffin, member of Alpha, Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, Delta Omega Omega Chapter. I am honored this afternoon to be able to present this symbolic token of our gratitude for your contribution to the history of our dear sorority, your contribution to our women's history, your contribution to our Black history, your contribution to our American history, and your contribution to our world history. Humbly, I say thank you, Ms. Raye.
Good evening. My name is Jasmine Pugh, and on behalf of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated Alpha Rho Chapter, I would like to present this gift to Ms. Raye for being our very own hidden figure. We thank you for everything that you've done in this class. Good evening. On behalf of the Youth Ministry, Breath of Life Church, and After School Engineer Studies, we are proud to present what they have designed for Mrs. Montague, the young people in my department, and they thank her very much. We gave way to her. So we thank her very much for what she's going to do for us. Thank you.
President of the Pine Bluff Chapter of the Links Incorporated. It is my pleasure to make this presentation to our dear sister Link, Raye Montague, for her outstanding leadership in the field of engineering. We recognize her today for her achievements and helping to pave the way for all women in her field, and especially women of color. She is truly our hero in all aspects of leadership and service. So on behalf of the Pine Bluff Chapter of the Links Incorporated, I am honored to present this gift to her on this special Founders Day ceremony for Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated.
Good evening. To all the beautiful ladies of AKA, that includes my wife. 109 years of this good on you. Congratulations. And we thank you for your service and your dedication to this community and also your leadership. Mrs. Montague, come on. 3. On behalf of our poet, our brother Archer Sanders, and all the noble men of Kappa Alpha Psi, we'd like to present these beautiful pink roses to Mrs. Montague. Not only just for the message, but for who she is.
I've learned a lot of things in my short life. First and foremost, I want to acknowledge my wife, Tasha Woods, who is a member of this esteemed sorority, Delta Omega Omega. I rise on behalf of the Kappa Alumni Chapter and also the Gamma Sigma Chapter of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated. I was initiated in 2002 following this university. After matriculating in the Gamma Sigma Chapter. Going through the process, not only did I learn the history of our own fraternity, but also the history of sororities. There's a deep, rich history, and I think Dr. McCray talked about some of the history of the sorority. But saying that, I'll leave with this quote. No matter which letters you wear, the following quotes still hold true. Better yet, they're still undeniably relevant. At the both of our sororities and fraternities and sisterhoods, first you're a part of it, it becomes a part of you. Sororities like Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated symbolize all that we will hope to accomplish in our lives. They represent the struggles we all face as we grow. While we cling to them, no one can ever know or explain. But to that end, it makes us stronger. Sisterhood is the essence of wisdom of all ages distilled into a single word. You cannot see sisterhood, neither can you hear it or taste it, but you feel it 100 times a day. It's a part of the backbone of us. It makes us smile, makes us encouraged, makes us share in our celebration of achievements. This is the epitome of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, the Delta Omega Omega Chapter, and also the Alpha Rho Chapter. Dr. McCray gave some brief history about the sorority, but as I stated previously, when I was initiated to the Gamma Sigma Chapter here on campus in fall of 2002, I did my own research. We had 10 founders. One of our noble founders, Elder Watson Diggs. You all may be familiar with Lucy Diggs Slope. That's very important for me to know that and know the history she played, not only in her sorority, but our fraternity. I learned that the history, late night sleeping, basically last night trying to creep up on my history. It's been a long time since I pledged, but I was reminded that she was the first president after the bylaws and things like that were reformed. The requirement she had to be a senior to hold that post. She also was the first to become the dean of Howard University, our nation's capital, African American dean. And with that being said, I won't hold you any longer. I want to present this to President Speaker Robertson. Would you please stand? Most of you have heard people say in church and other places that not every good man is a good woman, right? Well, I'm here to tell you that behind every good woman is a good man, a good Kappa man. No offense, Judge Brown. I said to say this, I want to also acknowledge Mr. Robinson, her husband, who's a member of our esteemed fraternity. Would you wave your hands? I know you are. Thank you.
My name is Demetrius Anderson. I'm the Vice Provost of the Gamma City Chapter of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated. And first, I'd like to congratulate you on your 109th anniversary. While sitting in the back there, I found something special about the numbers 1, 0, and 9. So for 1, you are the first and number one sorority, and today is your day. Zero, there is no other sorority like Alpha Kappa, Alpha. And number 9, you are the integral part of the Divine Nine. All right. So if you add 1, 0, and 9, it gives you 10, which you are perfect 10. The chapter of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated to present these roses to the Afro chapter.
With the golden members, please stand as I call your name. Gwendolyn Cooper, Jacqueline McRae, Katrine Horton, Carolyn Blakely, Ursuline Turner, Dorothy McFadden, Barbara Gathan, Lily Manuel. And although she is not a member of Delta Omega Omega Chapter, but Beta Pi Omega Chapter, I would be remiss if I did not acknowledge Ms. Reggie and Montague as a golden star. Silver stars represent a quarter of a century, seasoned perspectives, and work beyond measure. We salute you for lighting the paths that we follow as members. Silver members, when I call your name, please come forward and receive your silver star. Dietrich Kemp. Marsha West. Chandra Griffin. Christy Vigil. Sammy Thomas, Eliza Williams, and Ruthie Clemens. My apologies. Please let me clarify that the young ladies on stage right now are our newest Silver Star members. With all of our Silver Star members, please stand. Thank you all for your continued service.
Ladies and gentlemen, we want to thank you so much for attending this afternoon and for your patience, and I'm sure it was well worth your staying here. Raye Jean was phenomenal, and we're very, very pleased to have you here. In the absence of our Greek medley, what we're going to do today is just recognize members of various sisterhoods and brotherhoods. But before we do that, Don't we have some members of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority here who are not members of Delta Omega Beta or Alpha Rho? Would you stand, please? I know I'm the one. So will members of Delta Sigma Theta please stand? I can't sing your song, I don't have any music, but we want to recognize you. Members of Zeta Phi Beta, would you please stand? We recognize them anyway. Members of Sigma Gamma Rho Sorority, would you please stand? Members of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, would you please stand?
We also love to recognize all of the fraternities. Do we have any members of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity? Any men of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity? Omega Psi Phi Fraternity? Men of Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity? And any men of Iota Phi Beta Fraternity?
Again, you've been a magnificent audience, and again, we appreciate your being here, and good evening.